Understanding and also the appreciation for the body. Now we have to understand that there is a parallel in the spiritual life. So we have to understand that as we mature spiritually, we gain a better understanding when it comes to the church. Amen, Paul? Which is Christ's body. So it has helped to counteract. The Holy Spirit helps to counteract the wrong emphasis on what we call the individual Christianity that can lead to isolation from the local church. We have to understand that the image of the body is not the only one here Apostle Paul used in discussing the church. But we must be careful not to press it too far. The church is also a family. The church is also an army. And also the church is a temple. Of course, even as a bride. Now, in these letters, we can see Paul gave emphasis of the body of the church as the body. And we will study here its passages, the important truths about unity, diversity, and also maturity. So we have to know as well that it is important to discuss the body. No? Because without discussing the ministry of the Holy Spirit, we have to take note that the Spirit ministers in and through the body. What we can see here, if we're going to read the whole chapter, is that the Corinthian church, unfortunately here, the members were grieving the Holy Spirit. For what reason? By their carnal ways in which they were using spiritual gifts. And also, they were like children with toys instead of adults with valuable tools, and they needed to mature. So, as what I've said, let me share a message entitled, Everybody Has Something, But Nobody Has Everything. Now, let us take a look here in verses 1 to 13. Now, in verses 1 to 3, you know, we can see here, first, when it comes to unity. No? In verses 1 to 3, the Bible tells us, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Ye know that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. Wherefore, I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus cursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost." Now, we have to understand here that under this unity, we confess the same Lord. Amen? Now, Paul here contrasted their experience as unconverted idolaters here with the present experience as Christians. Why? What happened here? They had worshipped dead idols, but now they belong to the living God. Their idols here, as what Apostle Paul said, never spoke to them, but God spoke to them by His Spirit. And He even spoke through them in the gift of prophecy. So when they were lost, according to Apostle Paul, they were under the control of the demons. In 1 Corinthians 10:20, let us go there, please. 1 Corinthians 10:20. "But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to the devils and not to God, and I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils." Now, not only that, when they were lost, they were also led astray. Now, when the Bible tells us, carried away in chapter 12, verse 2, "Ye know that ye were Gentiles carried away." So they were led astray. But now, by the grace of God, according to Apostle Paul, the Spirit of God lived in them and directed in them. We have to understand that it is through the Spirit that the person can honestly say that Jesus is Lord. We can say that deep within our hearts. that Jesus is Lord. But those sneering sneering, or those people who are just smiling, but actually on the reaction or on the image of their face, they're scorning, may mouth the words, they might also say that Jesus is Lord. But they are not giving true confession. Now, another thing that we have to understand is that it is important to know that the believer is always in control of himself when the Holy Spirit is at work. Yes, in chapter 14, verse 3 of 1 Corinthians, but he that prophesieth, speaking unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort. So the Holy Spirit is at work. Not only that, because Jesus Christ the Lord is in charge. Yes, we have Christ in us. We have the Holy Spirit in us. That's why any so-called spirit manifestation that robs a person of self-control is not of God. Why? It is very clear here in the Word of God in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23, that the fruit of the Spirit is what? Temperance or self-control. That is what the Bible tells us. So if Jesus Christ truly is the Lord in our lives, then there should be unity in the church. Yes, there should be unity in the church. Division or dissension or disagreements among God's people only weakens their united testimony to a lost world. That's why in John 17 verses 20 to 21, it's very clear here. John 17, 20 to 21. Neither pray I for thee alone, these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Amen? So, we confess the same Lord. Not only that, in verses 4 to 6, the Bible tells us, now, let's go to our text, chapter 12, verses 4 to 6, now there are diversities, or distinctions of gifts, but the same Spirit, verse 5, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. Again, I'm not going to explain too much on this because we are consuming our time. But again, another thing here, that we depend on the same God. Yes, we depend on the same God. Here in these verses here, there is a Trinitarian emphasis here. First, the same Spirit, the same Lord, and the same God. We may individually have different gifts, ministries, or ways of working, but we have to understand and put in our minds that it is God that is working. Let us read Philippians 2:13. For it is God which worketh in you, amen, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Oh, both to do will and to do good. We have to understand that God's work in us extend to the transformation of our will, as well as changing our actions. That is to do in the text. And also of his good pleasure. It means that this is the motive behind God's work in our life. He does it because it gives him what? Pleasure to do it. Amen? That's why the source of the gift is God. Amen? And the sphere of administering the gift is from God. And also the energy here to use the gift is from God. That's why the question is, why then glorify men? Why do we glorify men? We have to understand that it is the working of God, not on these people. Why glorify men? And the other question is, why compete one with another? We depend on the same God. Without God, we cannot do anything. But sad to say, we idolize people. It's really sad. Now, I admit that when I was still in the Philippines, talagang pagbombastic ang preacher. Tuwang-tuwa ako. But later, I found out hindi pala dapat. Why? We don't need to glorify men. It should be God must be glorified. Not only that, 7 to 11. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For verse 8, for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. Verse 9, to another faith by the same Spirit, and to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. Verse 10, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. Verse 11, but all these things worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. Not only we confess the same Lord, we depend on the same God, but we minister to the same body. Amen? We have to understand that the gifts are given for the good of the whole church. We have to put that in mind. They are not for individual enjoyment, but for corporate employment. Now what we can see here is that the Corinthians especially needed this reminder. Why? Because they were using spiritual gifts selfishly. No? To promote themselves and not to prosper the church. That's why we have to be very careful. So when we accept our gifts with humility, then we use them to promote harmony, and this helps the whole church. That's why everybody has something, but nobody has everything. Now, the various gifts are named here in 1 Corinthians 12, 8 to 10, but we already read that one. Also here in verse 28. We can also see that in Ephesians 4:11. Let's take a look there, please. Ephesians 4:11. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors, and teachers. Let's proceed to Romans 12, 6 to 8, please. Verses 6 to 8. Having then gifts, differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that sheweth mercy with cheerfulness. That's why when you combine all this list, you end up with 19 different gifts here and offices. So, but again, we may assume that Apostle Paul was not attempting to exhaust the subject in either of these passages in 1 Corinthians, in Ephesians also, and in Romans. Why? Because while the gifts named are adequate for the ministry of the church, we have to understand that God is not limited to this list. We have to put that in mind. He may give other gifts as he pleases. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 1 to 6. Now we can see there the apostle. Now, we have to understand that Pastor Joel already shared it to us. The qualification of the apostles, or by the apostle first, is that he is a personal witness of the resurrected Christ. That's the first qualification. Now we can see that in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 to 9. Second thing is that He was personally chosen by the Lord Jesus Christ. Though, you can see that in Luke 6:13. And also, a personal disciple or a personal student of Jesus Christ. The same book, Luke 6:13, and not only that, he is able to perform miracles as well. In Acts 2:43. That's why if there are still some people who are existing right now who will proclaim themselves as apostle, they're fake. They're fake. Now, again, prophets were New Testament spokesmen for God, whose messages came immediately from God by the Spirit. We have to understand that their ministry was to edify, encourage and comfort as well. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 14, verse 3. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 3. But he that prophesieth speaketh unto men to edification. That's very important. And exhortation and comfort. That's why their messages were tested by the listeners to determine whether they were truly from God. Why? There are many people who are teaching, they're so-called teachers of the Word of God, but actually they're not. So, in 1 Corinthians 4:29, let us go there please. Verse 29, same chapter please. 1 Corinthians 4:14-29, let the prophet speak two or three, and let the other judge. And also 1 Thessalonians 5:19-21, but we're not going to go there anymore. It makes it clear that the apostles and prophets what? Work together to lay the foundation of the church. Not only that, teachers, also called as pastor teacher, they were instructed, converts in the doctrinal truths of the church or the Christian spirit help. So again, Christian life. They taught from the word and from the teachings of the apostles. And also, though the Spirit helped them in their teaching, it indicates that it's also a serious calling. Amen? This is the highest calling. This is a serious calling. Why? Being a pastor, you can ask Pastor Joel about that. It's not easy. That is not an easy job. That is not an easy task. That's why the pastor needs our prayers. We need to help them. But don't say something against them. Okay? If you have a problem with the pastor, then talk to the pastor and discuss the matter. We need unity. Amen? We need to have understanding. That's why those people who don't have the maturity when it comes to the Word of God, then they will do something that will divide the church. It's really sad. Sa bagay, mga baguhan talaga eh. Dito lang natuto. Anyway, let's go there. I'm sorry. Emotion. No. Madali akong maapektuhan. Next, the evangelist. The evangelist majored on sharing the good news of salvation with the lost. Also, all ministers should do the work of the evangelist. Now, let's proceed to 2 Timothy 4:5. I'm sorry. 2 Timothy 4:5. But watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. The evangelist. Oh. They seek and win souls. But some men have been given evangelism as a what? Special calling. No? I don't know for the others, but you can ask Pastor Joel in the States. There are evangelists, right? Pastor, tapos they go to different churches, so that's the work. No, this is another ministry that we can say is a good work as well for God's purpose. No, why? In the early church, miracles were also part of the credentials of God's servants. We can let's take a look in Hebrews 2, 1 to 4. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Verse 2, please, until 4. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience receive a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, with diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. But again, in fact, miracles, healings, and tongues all belong to what the theologian says, the sign gifts, and belong to a special way to the infancy of the church. But again, the book of Acts, as well as church history, indicates that these miraculous gifts passed off the scene. Amen? But again, we can still believe that until right now, God is still working to heal somebody. Amen? But again, there are healing crusades that are happening right now. But again, it's up to them, especially to those people who are believing those kind of crusades. No? Somebody cannot walk and then they will just go directly in front, and then that preacher will hold that area, the part of the body, then suddenly it can walk straight. Oh, but actually, that's all business. Oh, nakakalungkot. Not only that, helps and governments have to do with the serving of others and guiding of the church. That's why, because without the spiritual leadership, the church flounders, or it will struggle to move. That's why in the church, there's a pastor who is leading us. Amen? By the grace of God. And with the work of the body as well, so that they can work properly to glorify the Lord. Now, in Romans 12:7, please. Or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching. So, not only that, there were several speaking gifts, tongues, and the interpretation of tongues. But again, the word of wisdom and also the word of knowledge, when we say the word of wisdom of the word of knowledge, this is the ability to understand and also to apply God's word of truth in our lives. And also exhortation, encouragement, and rebuke if necessary as well. Now, as we continue, giving and showing mercy also relate to sharing material aid with those in need. Now, as well as the supporting God's servants in the ministry. Now, whether you like it or not, it is our job to help the servants of God, to help them financially. That is a work as well. We need to do that. That is our responsibility. Now, the gift of faith has to do with believing God for what he wants to accomplish in the church ministry, that he will lead and provide. And also, we have to understand that the discerning of spirits was very important in the church, early church. Why? Because Satan tried to counterfeit also the work of God. No? And the word of God. That's why today the Spirit especially uses the written word to give us discernment. That's very important. Let's take a look in 1 John 2, 18 to 24. 1 John 2, 18 to 24. Little children, it is the last time, and as you have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. That is true. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. But ye have an unction from the Holy One, and ye know all things. I have not written unto you because ye know not the truth, but because ye know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist, that denieth the Father and the Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father. But he that acknowledgeth the Son hath the Father also. Lastly, please. Let that therefore abide in you, which ye have heard from the beginning. If that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, ye also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. That's why, since then, we need not to worry about false prophets. But we do have to beware of false teachers. Oh, 2 Peter 2:1. Let's go there, please. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord, that both them bring upon themselves swift destruction. Ano ba yan? Pronunciation ko sa ngipin ko. Masyado napahaba. Hindi ko pa napatabas. Anyway. So, we have to be aware of that. But again, in order for us to know if a person is teaching the truth or not, let's go to the Word of God. That's very important. Because if you are familiar with the Word of God, then you know what to do. And you can easily discern if something is wrong with the message. That's why some students here have categorized the various gifts as speaking gifts, the sign gifts, and the serving gifts. However, we should not be so fascinated, okay, or be attracted by the individual gifts that we forget the main reason why Paul listed them here in this chapter of 1 Corinthians 12. We have to be reminded that this unites us in our ministries to the one body. We have to understand that the Holy Spirit bestows these gifts as He will. Amen? As He will. In chapter 12, verse 11, but all this worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as He will. As God will. Amen? Not as we will. That's very important. That's why no Christian should complain about his or her gifts. Nor should any believer boast his or her gifts. Nobody should boast about that. We are many members in one body ministering to each other. That's the important thing there. Not only that, 12 to 13. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. We'll explain this later on. Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. Another point is that we have experienced the same baptism. Now, God has spoken to us in Spirit-given words that we must not be confused. Now, let us take a look in 1 Corinthians 2, chapter 2, 12 to 13. I'm sorry if we have a lot of verses. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Amen? We must not be confused on that. No? The baptism of the Spirit occurs or happens at the conversion when the Spirit enters the believing person. That is the baptism of the Spirit. It gives him new life and makes his body as the temple of God. That's why all believers have experienced this once for all baptism in 1 Corinthians 12:13. That's why nowhere does the scripture commands us to seek baptism, because we already have experienced it and it need not to be repeated. And when we say the filling of the Holy Spirit, okay, it has to do with that, with the Spirit's control of our lives. Now let us read Ephesians 5:18. Filling of the Spirit. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. That's very important. No? In the scripture, to be filled by something means to be controlled by. That is the meaning, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We are commanded to be filled, and we can be if we yield all to Christ and ask Him for the Spirit's filling. That's very important. So this is a repeated experience, for we constantly need to be filled with the spiritual power if we want to really glorify God in our lives. Well, that again, to be baptized by the Spirit means that we belong to Christ's body. And to be filled with the Spirit means that our bodies now belong to God, belongs to Christ. That's why the evidence of the Spirit's baptism at conversion is the witness of the Spirit within. Now let us read Romans 8:14 to 16. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So that is the Spirit's baptism at conversion. And it is the witness of the Spirit within. That's why all believers here in the Corinthian church or Corinthian assembly had been baptized by the Spirit, but not all of them spoke in tongues. Not all of them. That's why the evidences of the Spirit's filling are power for witnessing. Power for witnessing. Acts 1:8. Let us go there, please. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Okay? So for witnessing, not only that, in Ephesians 5:19 it is joyfulness and submission. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Amen? Joyfulness and submission. And also in Galatians 22 to 26, we're not going to read it anymore. Not only that, it is also Christ-likeness. Christ-likeness. And in John 16, 12 to 15, growing understanding of the word. This is very important. Let us read this, please. John 16:12 to 15. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall shew it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I, that he shall take of mine, and shall shew it unto you. That's why a growing understanding of the word. That's why if every member can gain or have these things, then unity is not impossible. Amen. That's why we have to be very careful. Because if you know the Word of God, then you know how to handle things. Amen. Again, we have experienced the same baptism. Now, because of the gift of the Spirit, which is received at conversion, we are all members of the body of Christ. Your race, your status, or your wealth here in Galatians 3:28 are no longer advantages or disadvantages or handicaps as we fellowship and serve the Lord. Let us read Galatians 3:28, please. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. So unity is very important. Amen? Not only that, when it comes to diversity, let's proceed to chapter 12, 14 to 31. That's why unity without diversity would produce uniformity. Okay? A state or a quality of being uniform. So, again, and uniformity tends to produce destruction or death. Why? Life is a balance between unity and diversity or distinction. That's why as a human body weakens, its system also slows down and everything tends to become uniform. So the ultimate, of course, is that the body itself, what? Turns to dust. That's what will happen to us. But again, this helps to explain why some churches and other Christian ministries have weakened. Why? There were no sufficient diversity to keep unity from becoming uniformity. We have to understand, we have differences. There are various gifts and responsibilities that God entrusted and given to us. And you have to be faithful in that and work for it for the glory of God. Amen? Try to take note. Paano pag pastor tayo lahat dito? Preach tayo lahat? Amen? Now, diversity. However, if diversity is not kept under control, it could destroy unity. And then you have now what they call anarchy or the lawlessness. Why? There is no absence of authority. That will happen right now. That's why we discover here in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 that there is maturity that balances unity and diversity. Now, the tension in the body between individual members and the total organisms can only be solved by maturity. Amen? Although nobody have really reached that out so far. Why? Because God is working in us every day in order for us to have these things. Not only that, The body needs different functions if it is to live, grow, and serve. Again, the body needs different functions or work if it is to live, grow, and serve. Remember that we can read that here in verses 14 to 20. Verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? And if, verse 16, and if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? 17, if the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them in the body, as it hath pleased him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, yet but one body. The body needs different functions if it is to live, grow, and serve. That's why no member should compare or contrast himself or herself with any member. Because each one is different and each one is very important. Don't compare yourself. Amen? Yes. We can learn how to walk using our hands. Bakit natin pahihirapan meron mong paa? Amen? Yes. We can type using our toes. But again, meron naman tayong mga kamay. Mga daliri para gamitin. That's why you have to understand that the ear cannot what? See. And the eye cannot hear. Tandaan po natin yan. Yet each organ has an important ministry. And the question is, have you ever tried to smell something using your eyes? Amen? Why? Because everybody has his own function and its own work. You are unique. And that is the purpose why God has designed the church. Amen? There is something in you that the others cannot do. That only God has given to you. That's why everybody has something, but nobody has everything. Now, there is a tendency today for some people to magnify the sensational or the senses or sensational gifts. But some believers felt that the guiltiness because they possess gifts that do not put them into limelight. And that's the problem. No? It is this attitude that Apostle Paul opposed and refuted in this paragraph. Why? Diversity here does not suggest inferiority. Amen? Yes. Huwag ka mainggit na ang pastor dito si Pastor Joel. You have your own function and you have to be faithful on that. Huwag ka mainggit at pag hindi ka hindi ka kumakanta sa choir or sa ensemble or sa mga special number kasi meron kang function na hindi namin pwedeng gawin, hindi pwedeng gawin ng iba. And be faithful on that. No? That's why the question is, are we to believe the sovereign Lord that he made a mistake when he bestowed those gifts? No. It is not God's fault. No. Instead, what we need to do is to be thankful to God for having these gifts. Oh, no, teacher, but the reason...
ang gift ko ay love gift lang. Napapaliya pa minsan. Ilang beses na akong na-deny. Tuloy lang. Amen? Wala akong pinapatamaan na nalangin. Nadaanan lang. Now, let's try to make it quick. It's almost time. So the members, not only that, 21 to 26. Here, not going to read it anymore because we already read it a while ago. The members promote unity as they discover their dependence on one another. Amen? The members promote unity as they discover their dependence on one another. That's why diversity in the body is the evidence of the wisdom of God. That's why each member needs one other members, and no member can afford to become independent. Independent Baptist Church lang tayo, mag-independent ka pa dyan. Right? When a part of the human body becomes independent, you have a serious problem that could lead to sickness and even destruction. That's why in a healthy human body, the various members, what? They cooperate with each other and even compensate for each other when the crisis occurs. And that's what we did, amen? Praise the Lord for that. Amen? That's why the instant any part of the body says that, I don't need you. You don't belong here. It begins to weaken and also create problems for the whole body. We need each other. Amen? Kahit ang arte-arte mo dyan, we need you. May puro makeup ka dyan, we need you. We need that. Why? Because God's desire is that there be no what? Division or schism in the church. Why? Because diversity leads to disunity when the members compete with one another. Ay, mas maganda ako sa'yo. Ay, mas pogi ako sa'yo. Tapos. Tingnan mo, bakit mag-pronounce? Dapat PF yung sasabi niya. Tingnan mo, Bisaya yun. No? Tapos tayo. Ayun. Tawa ka din, pareho tayo Bisaya. I'm just kidding. So again, but diversity leads to unity when the members, what? Care for one another. I like this. So how do the members care for each other? Why? When everybody is functioning according to God's will and helping the other members to function. That's why if one member suffers, it affects every member. If one member is healthy, it helps the others to be strong. Amen? And lastly, I have to finish this. Pastor, okay lang po. Ilang minuto lang po. Ilang minuto lang po, tatapusin ko po. And verse 27-31. Oh, I have to ask permission to pastor. Okay. Lastly, diversity of members fulfills the will of God in the body. Again, diversity of members fulfills the will of God in the body. So it is God who bestows the gifts and assigns the offices. Amen? So He has the perfect plan, not only for the church as a whole, but for each local congregation. That's very important. So we have no reason to believe that each congregation in the New Testament possess all the gifts. No, they did not possess all the gifts here. Because the church at Corinth was specially gifted assembly. Yes, they were gifted. The members there were Greeks. They have the Greek culture and they are knowledgeable. But again, they did not possess all those gifts. However, we have to understand that God gives to each congregation just the gifts it needs when they are needed. Amen? Ayun, pag-ayos mo ng mga kuryente din, mga ilaw, ano yan? Gift mo yan. So, paalagaan mo yan. Nagpi-play ka dyan ng maliit na gitara dyan. Ang tawag dyan? Violin, maliit na gitara. gift mo yan. So be faithful on that. So the construction of the Greek in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verses 29-30 here demands no answer. These are all questions. Okay? Are all apostles? Are all prophets? So on and so forth. The answer is no to this question. Why? No individual believer possesses all of the gifts. That's why everybody has something, but nobody has everything. Each believer has gifts assigned to him by the Lord and needed at the time. That's why unity and diversity must be balanced by maturity. And that maturity comes with love. So it is not enough to have the gifts of the Spirit and the gifts from the Spirit, but we must also have what? The graces of the Spirit as we use our gifts to serve one another. So I hope that this lesson will remind us that again, everybody has something, but nobody has everything. So again, be faithful to God, to those things that He entrusted to you, and always glorify God in your lives. Let us pray. Our loving Father, thank you once again for your faithfulness in our lives. Please be the one, Lord God, to enable us and help us, Lord God, to grow spiritually, to learn more from your word. Please continue to bless our church, Lord. Strengthen this every one of us. Please continue to bless our pastor.